We have with us the Minister of Shipping and Insular Policy, Mr. Ioannis Plakiotakis. This is one of the few areas where Greece has a global leadership. Mr. Plakiotakis has been promoting the cause of shipping and Greek shipping in particular globally, and we are delighted to have him with us. Mr. Minister, please come to the podium, and then we will proceed with the panel.
Distinguished representatives from the international business and shipping community, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor for me to participate. Okay. It is a great honor for me to participate to the 21st annual Capital Link Invest in Greece Forum among distinguished members of the international shipping and business community and share with you our vision, trust, and high expectations of the shipping sector for the years to come. Allow me first of all to congratulate Mr. Bornozis for your excellent organization of this forum and warmly thank you for honoring me to address it, especially this December, which marks the 21st year milestone of Capital Link's commitment to raising awareness about Greece as an investment destination to the wider business community. For the Minister for Maritime Affairs and Insular Policy, 2019 is also a landmark year since we celebrate the 100th anniversary of the Hellenic Coast Guard offering to our economy and society. Allow me also to underline the great importance we attach to our presence here today. Nowadays, after intense fiscal consolidation and structural reforms, under the leadership of Prime Minister Kyriakos Mitsotakis, the Greek economy is on an excellent track in the pathway to sustainable growth. Ladies and gentlemen, maritime transport is inextricably linked with developments in the global economy and seaborne trade. During the past year, global economy is undergoing a period of change, and this has a considerable effect on the demand side for shipping services. Generally speaking, the shipping industry has during the last years been under pressure stemming from overcapacity, low freight rates, and higher banking costs, altogether influencing the economies of the industry. Despite such difficulties, the internal and global economic environment, Greek shipping managed to retain its international position. This is due, of course, to professionalism and expertise and adaptability of our shipping industry, which, in contrast to support from the Greek government, managed to respond to the challenges and look with optimism towards the future. We used to say that the performance of maritime sector is witnessed by the fact that during the era of the ailing Greek economy, it was the only economic sector in Greece that kept its employment record unaffected. The shipping industry is by far the most extrovert sector of the national economy, a leading global player, and a major source of income, wealth, and prestige for Greece. In a rapidly changing world, Greek shipping in general is a reliable world trade player by covering a considerable part of the transportation needs of the world in energy and raw materials, and by playing a significant role as an excellent ambassador of our country in all major ports and trading centers worldwide. Allow me to present some figures that show the magnitude of the Greek shipping, which leads the international shipping industry by providing high-quality maritime services with a modern fleet and operating with the most up-to-date management techniques and the highest safety and environmental standards. The Greek merchandise fleets count 670 ships, In addition to the national fleet, Greek ship owners control an impressive number of more than 5,000 ships of various categories, with a carrying capacity of 400 million deadweight, distributed among 43 different flags around the globe. The fleet controlled by Greeks' interest is at a record high. Greek-owned fleet ranks first, accounting for 21% and 53% of the global and the European Union deadweight tonnage, respectively. The Greek shipping cluster is a uniquely successful bright spot in the Greek economy. More than 1,430 shipping companies active in ocean-going shipping and further 3,674 maritime companies active mainly in cabotage and short-sea shipping operate in Greece, highlighting Piraeus as a maritime center of global range and basis of expertise in vessel management. These companies offer direct employment to over 16,000 employees and constitute the driving force for the entire maritime cluster, employing directly and indirectly almost 200,000 people. The key contributing factor to the cluster's competitiveness is the highest degree of experience and expertise in shipping's genuinely competitive environment. Greek shipping remains a reliable, strategic provider of quality maritime transport services for its trading partners, both state and private, with 22.5% of the Greek owned fleet actively being dedicated to the United States. More than 25% of the US oil imports and 20% of US exports of dry bulk commodities are carried on Greek vessels. In addition, the greatest share of the Greek-owned fleet activity, i.e. 31.8%, takes place in Asia, serving the fast-growing Asian economies. Despite an economic landscape offering few investment incentives, the receipts in the service balance of payments for maritime transport reached 16.6 billion euros in 2018, representing 90% of our GDP. It is obvious that Greek shipping substantially underpins the development of our national economy, bringing at the same time the added value to all connected sectors, employment on board and onshore as the head of the Greek maritime clusters. In terms of identifying shipping policy priorities, it comes without saying that the major emphasis is placed upon the improvement of the competitiveness of the sector, the uptake of new opportunities from digitalization to automation, which can reduce operational costs and increase efficiency and the human factor and the necessity to maintain maritime know-how by ensuring the constant upgrade of the maritime education. Moreover, and it is a crucial and most important priority in our ministry, is the revitalization of the seamanship of our people remains a priority. And for me, personally, as a Minister of Maritime and Insular Policy, in order not to lose our national maritime capability and know-how. To this aim, there are three prerequisites. The enhancement, first of all, of the image of the seafaring profession in order to attract young people. The improvement of the maritime training system, as well as of the capability of the marine academies. So we are going to develop our public maritime academy system. As well, we are going to introduce the private education, the private marine education in our region, as all the competitive shipping nations do these days. And also, I would like to improve the status and the competitiveness of the national registry in order to attract more ships in the Greek flag. It is difficult and demanding task, but I hope that I will fulfill this during my term. Also, it is more than evident that living in a truly globalized environment, we have to recognize the trends and the new challenges in order to be able to identify the barriers to trade and capital mobility and to make best use of technological progress so as to maximize efficiency and reduction of cost. In this dynamic and volatile economic environment, we, as policymakers, should be able to decide and act on the basis of a strategic vision looking to the development of shipping and related sector for the short, medium, and long term. This is, of course, essential for all decision makers and those who shape maritime policies at national and international level. The realistic implementation of the IMO initial strategy on the reduction of GHG emission from shipping and the consistent and smooth implementation of the new 0.5% low sulfur limit from 1st of January 2020 by ensuring global availability of safe, compliant fuels remain high on our agenda. Soon, in the beginning of 2020, in the following 8 weeks, Hellenic Republic Asset Management Fund, the well-known TAIPED, will present to our ministry feasibility studies for the rest of 10 big peripheral ports of the country for which there is already, I can assure you for that, there is already strong investment interest. Greece is a crossroads of three continents, and its geostrategic position and geopolitical position is, of course, ideal. The political and economical stability that exists these days in Greece justifies the investors' interest. In particular, for each port, it is carried out a rigorous feasibility study. We would like to know the real potential so that every decision can be targeted for their development, and that is why we believe that ports can become growth locomotives for both the region and the Greece national economy. Ladies and gentlemen, today the economic profile of Greece is changing steadily and constitutes a solid base for the development of our national economy, which allows us to attack new investment, which is in turn will contribute in the growth and prosperity in Greece. In this respect, our shipping industry is traditionally, as it was for centuries in our maritime history, the main economic pillar underpinning new investment, growth, and development. And do not forget that shipping is in our DNA. In closing, on behalf of the Ministry of Maritime Affairs and Insular Policy, but also on behalf of the Greek commercial and maritime community as a whole, I would like once again, Mr. Bornozis, to express my honor to address this forum, and I'm convinced that once more it will lead us to important conclusion and will reveal the great potential of the Greek maritime community. Thank you very much for your attention.
Mr. Minister, thank you very much for your remarks, and thank you for leading essentially the world's largest fleet and for raising the flag in terms of the industry's causes. So now we will proceed with shipping panel, and then we will have Thomas come back and close the forum. We have so I will let Costas Paris from Wall Street Journal introduce the panelists and lead the discussion. Mr. Plakiotakis has recently been at the IMO, has been in China, he's been all over the place advocating the cause of Greek shipping and shipping in general. So,
yes. All right. Don't speak too loud, you're going to wake up the people, eh? Take it easy.
I know that, yes. Thanks. Thanks, Nico. welcome to New York, everybody, those who travel from Greece and from other places around the world. To start with, I just want to say thumbs up to Nikos and Olga Bornozis, who I have put this pretty impressive gathering together.
Like the Chinese.
Now they're to tell you the truth, it's been a while. Actually, I think it's been a decade since I saw so many smiles and optimism in a Greek investment forum. And the last time that I saw it was for all the wrong reasons. This time, it looks like Greece has hit the bottom and that it is moving ahead. It's obvious that we can't go any lower, so the only way is to go up. And this government shows that it has the willingness to push things forward. But in this forum, this is a shipping forum. This is not a forum where you're going to hear in any way or form that Greece is back. Shipping has been in its own crisis for over a decade and still struggling with it. And it is facing headwinds as the global economy and global trade is in the horizon. But shipping is kind of, I've been covering it now for a while. And shipping, what I've realized is that shipping is an interesting part of business. Shipping basically, if you ask these guys here, they're all gonna tell you that they all like plain sailing and growth and steady but slow growth and all this. It's all lies. These guys thrive in turmoil. And let me tell you what has happened. Most of you probably know President Trump just a couple of months ago decided to blacklist the Costco tanker fleet. Overnight, a good proportion of VLCCs just disappeared while Costco was trying to figure out what the hell is going on, which ships are blacklisted, and for what reason those ships had nothing to do with Iran that the United States was accusing. While they were trying to do this, oil needed to be moved around the world. It's also the winter season, and oil is very, very important. So, Mr. Tsakos, who is already a wealthy man, became a very wealthy man.
Don't tell this to my wife. And for a few days only.
Freight rates jumped overnight from, Nikos knows this much better, he will say it, but quadrupled. They went all the way up to, what was it, 300,000? 300,000 a day with a break-even level of less than 20,000. It's just like money in your pocket day in and day out, hundreds of thousands of dollars. So shipping thrives in turmoil, operates in turmoil. Mr. Plakiotakis said that shipping is in our DNA, so if I may say, turmoil is also in the Greek DNA. To introduce our panel, Mr. Tsakos right here to my left is one of the biggest tanker ship owners in the world. I will not go into his impressive accolades to save time. Mr. Zafirakis, who is from Diana Shipping, he is the chief strategy officer. They operate a fleet of dry bulk vessels. And then Mr. Pittas, Aristides Pittas, very known name in the industry, runs Euroseas and Eurodry, which runs container ships, box ships, and dry bulk vessels. So there's just a few points where I want to lead the discussion First is the trade war. It's more than a year in effect. We have seen trade volumes fall, especially for container ships, but also other ships as well. I would like to ask our guests, how much has this affected your business, and how important is it for a trade agreement between the U.S. and China to be reached? Nikos.
Well, we in shipping, we consider ourselves, I would say, the truck drivers of the seas. So we need the open roads, no barriers on the roads. As you said, turmoil might, for a short period of time, create some pockets of high rates, but long term is very negative for our business, for the shipping business in general. So it is biting. Energy is not yet affected by those cuts, and that's why the tanker market has been able to sustain a positive year with good prospects going forward. But I think Aristides, on the container side, you're much more expert to let us know, because I think that's a sector that has been affected.
Yes, container trade is very much correlated with the global GDP. Global GDP has been affected, as the economists say, through the war that Mr. Trump has opened on trade, primarily with China, but also with other players as well. This year we have a global GDP growth of around 3%, which is lower than what everybody anticipated at the beginning of the year, because everybody was anticipating that the trade war issues would have been resolved between China and the US, and generally we would have more growth. So this fact, the fact that the world is growing slower because of the trade wars, has an effect on every business, on sentiment, on everything. And I think that until this is somehow resolved, we will be feeling the consequences of a lower global GDP growth, which affects containers more. I want to add one more statistic. For the first time in I don't know how many years, history maybe, we have had a contraction of the trade between the US and China on container trade about 8%. This is a huge drop in the container trade between the two countries. I think that says enough.
First of all, let me thank you for the invitation. But I have to be remunerated better, because the other panels, they were having 5-6 people talking. We are only three. We're going to talk more.
The good, the bad, and the ugly.
Also, yes, yes.
The good ones.
And another reason, I thought, last being the last panel, it was going to be much fewer people here. But
no. Yeah,
anyway, so it's okay. Next time. Okay. Yeah. I thought it was going to be. Yeah. Anyway, talking.
You invited the waiters down.
Yes, yeah. As regards your question, another reason why I'm usually invited is because I usually disagree with the others, and I'm going to start like this. Actually, the trade war presents a bad thing about demand, but at the same time, because our industry is very much influenced by supply and sentiment, it creates a really bad sentiment, which keeps the supply level very low. So indirectly, if the fear meter is on the higher side than what should have been, the net effect is medium to long-term positive. So you may see a decrease in demand because of the trade war, the difficulties in financing, the introduction of new environmental regulation. But at the end of the day, if the sentiment about the market being really, really bad and keeps the supply level very low, the net effect is positive for us. And this is our belief, that we are not here to tell you that demand is not going to go down. It certainly is down and is going down, but the supply has been kept, because of all of these reasons, very low, which makes the gap bigger or wider than what it used to be before, and therefore the net effect, medium to long term, may be positive.
We don't disagree with you, Yanni, on this. For once, we agree. Supply, let me just add that. Supply indeed has been kept very low, and this is the most encouraging thing for our business. One reason is the fear factor that Yanni says, and of course the other reason is that nobody knows what kind of fuel we will be using in the future, and when somebody builds a new ship, he builds it for 20, 25 years. So obviously if the fuel that you're going to be using will not be used 10 years down the line, it makes an investment decision very difficult.
Right, which brings me to the next chapter. But before I go this, I just wanted to ask you, Nikos, for the tanker run, how long do you see it lasting and why, as briefly as we can?
Well, if I knew this, I would not have been here tonight, but no, I would. Well, I think the short term, unless we have some sort of geopolitical event that will change the momentum. Right now, we are seeing a very good fourth quarter. We're seeing the first half of 2020 looking positive. I think 2020, you know, will be a good year, and perhaps 6 months after that. And I think that's as far as we can say, because everything has to do, as you Aristides said, with the supply. If we see people start ordering ships that will come in the market in 2 years, that will put a damper in the market immediately. So I think we have a good 18 months going forward.
18 and a half.
Right. I want to spend a good part of our discussion with the time we've left here on your new generation of ships and what drives your decisions. But the first switch is January 1st next year, just a few days away, which basically you guys are going to be asked to pay either around 30% as prices are now more in fuel, or you have invested heavily in exhaust systems called scrubbers to comply with IMO regulations. It's the biggest change in shipping in 100 years, and as the General Secretary of the IMO, Mr. Kitaglim, told me, it will be the most expensive one by far. Now, the IMO has a roadmap. It has given assurances that there's going to be enough new fuel in major ports around the world, and the quality of the fuel is good. Again, Mr. Lim told me that in test runs, a lot of test journeys, the new fuel is performing brilliantly. That's what he said. So he's the General Secretary of the IMO, and I will take him, or we should take him by his word. But the biggest ship owners in the world, Greece, have a lot of doubts. I was discussing it with Nikos before we came in. He said, well, it's a democracy. We can say whatever we want, which is absolutely true.
We still have a democracy.
We still have a democracy, absolutely true. But it seems like the Greeks, which run about 20% of the world fleet, are pushing back for a delay. I would like, the question is this to all three of you. Why are you pushing up for a delay? Why you're not taking what the IMO is telling you for granted, that this is the case? And isn't it true that other people that have either invested in scrubbers or in getting the new fuel have invested already quite heavily, expect a level playing field by all players, which of course includes the Greeks, which are the world's biggest ship owners? They expect you to play by the rules. So what are your concerns, and what effect would that have in the market, if any?
Well, I think, first of all, we should not give the wrong impression. I think, as I said, you know, we have a democracy. I strongly believe that the whole bunkering issue is an issue of the providers and not of the ship owners, so I agree with the Greek position that there should be a delay, but there's not going to be a delay. So, I mean, the only thing I'm saying is, being the largest nation in shipping, we have a strong position, we have to follow the rules, but because, as we said, we still have a democracy, we are allowed to say, being the largest country and the biggest operators in this business that things are not, they're not ready to happen. But we are going to follow what has, what the international forum have agreed to follow. So please do not give the impression that Greece is under the table trying to change anything. I think now it's too late for anything to be changed.
I think the only thing that Greece has done is express its concerns if there is actually this fuel which is sufficient and compatible, and we will not have problems burning this fuel or changing from one fuel to the other fuel. And this is something that we will be seeing. The decision has been taken. We totally agree on the IMO taking the decisions. We try to influence them, and we should try to influence them. We think we understand more than anybody else what shipping is all about. But the decision is taken. We will abide. We hope that there will not be too many problems, but there is a risk that we will see problems.
Most of the Greek owners, they like this environmental change, and they are there to use, most of them, the low sulfur fuel. What most of the Greek ship owners are doing is they are opposed to the installation of scrubbers. There are many reasons why the installation of scrubbers is the wrong thing to do. First of all, it's a separate investment. It's investing in something, you invest a particular amount of money, and you expect to get something back in return. If you do the numbers, you will see that there are so many unknowns in this equation that it doesn't make a real sense to do that. From the moment you can comply by utilizing the low sulfur fuel, I think it's going to be proven in the future that you are protecting the environment better than having an open loop scrubber where you're throwing all the residues into the sea back again. Regardless of the research that has been done up to now, I think in few months there will come environmentally saying that you are creating a film and you are creating a problem to the reproduction of fish. And I don't want to say it differently. Things like that is going to happen, and I think the whole scrubber story at the end of the day is going to be proven as a real bad investment. I know that the other companies that they have spent a lot of money in scrubbers are going to come up and say, we took an insurance by utilizing scrubbers. But sometimes people do mistakes, and I think that's one of them. And I have to restate the fact that there is no Greek company that I know that they are not there to comply with the IMO new regulation.
Okay.
Scrubbers. And I know many companies.
Yeah. Scrubbers, just to put things into perspective, scrubbers is a business decision, and it's still an IMO-approved method. There are a lot of concerns about them, but it's still an IMO-approved method. I saw a headline that said Greta Thunberg is going to come after scrubbers. Good Lord. Imagine if that thing happened. You would all run. Can even if you didn't have scrubbers. But let's go to the next.
Before we go, I just want to say one thing about scrubbers.
Yes.
Perhaps it will pay out as an investment, perhaps not. We will see. What I didn't like in this whole thing is that we decided to allow this scrubber thing to happen and to allow this kind of investment, which is $10 billion if you calculate how many scrubbers have already been installed, which the industry would have done much better if we had invested it in some kind of research for the new kind of fuel, which is what is needed. So that is my main concern, that we and the IMO allowed this thing to happen, whilst perhaps it would have been better to invest all this money in new research and make obligatory the use of low sulfur fuel oil for everybody.
All right.
I just wanted to say it. I never said it before. I needed it.
Well done. Well done. Very nice.
This is going, by the way, ladies and gentlemen, people who invest in shipping or are here looking into shipping investments. This is going to cost the industry $50 billion over the next five years. That's a lot of money, right? These guys have to invest buy new fuels. It's about 50% of their cost. They have to pass it on to their customers. The customers have to pass it on the supply chain. And I will buy my pair of jeans for about 50 cents more at the end of the day. That's how it goes. But it's a lot of money for these guys, and it's even more money come 2050. 2050 is 30 years away, but it's a very, very short time for...
We will be retired by then.
So you'll be fine.
Or dead.
So you'll be fine.
But the way the Greek companies work, the way Greek workers are running the business.
It's probably going to be a new Tsakos at the helm, so you want to put things right for him. Anyway, or her. The idea is that we're talking here about a whole new generation of ships, right? Zero carbon emissions, or 50% by 2050, and eventually going zero. You guys are talking about something which is totally unknown. That's what I'm going to ask. Is it totally unknown? Is the new fuels, ammonia or hydrogen or biofuels or ethylene or whatever, is totally unknown? From the reporting that I've done, basically nobody has the slightest idea right now, we're just starting testing. How big is a challenge is going to be for your businesses? Are you going to be able to survive this? And is the deadline too tight? Thank you.
Well, I think Mr. Zafirakis mentioned this. I think there is a big positive fear factor, which is true. 2030 is 10 years ago. No one wants to order a ship today that after 10 years might be obsolete. So this makes people stop ordering. We have enough ships anyway out there. So I think this is very positive for the market. To build a new ship, the actual construction of a ship creates a lot of emissions also. So by keeping the existing ships, as I have said, slow steaming from now until 2030, by reducing the speed of the ships by 10%, we are able to reduce our environmental footprint substantially. And as you said, it's going to be a game changer. Up to very recently, we thought gas, dual gas, would be the answer. There's a lot of talk that gas really does not comply with the methane CO2.
Methane and CO2 both.
With methane and CO2 right now. So I think we are in a situation that we have to stay put. There are enough ships to do the job, we will all looking at technologies coming forward. But we are in new territory. And,
Mr. Pittas.
I just want to add that I cannot imagine the cargo of the world being carried by anything else than ships. It is so much, much more economical and less polluting than trucks, trains, airplanes, whatever else can be used to carry around commodities. The fraction is by a fraction of 100 times. It's not close at all. So the ships will be here, they will be needed. We do hope that we are able to find the right fuel in time to effect the change in the smoothest possible way. In the absence of that, the only thing that we can really do is try to go slower, steam slower, because there are a lot of economies achieved and much less carbon dioxide produced if we go slower. And this is the only interim solution that really works. Other than that, we have to research and spend a lot of money to find the new fuel, because we don't have enough time to achieve the goals that we want.
I have to repeat myself saying that all of these challenges, at the same time, they create opportunities for the big companies like ours. And from the moment you are the last one to die, you get everything, basically. And we strongly believe that we should not be the ones, as Diana Shipping, trying to do something first. We we know very well that the people that they found, they discovered America, they were not the ones that they made money, settlers did. So we have to wait, be strong enough to follow what is happening. And we see that, I keep saying, as an opportunity. And I'm going to repeat one of my best jokes.
To end the session,
yes. I see the time. There were two guys hiking in the forest, and suddenly a bear came chasing them. The one stopped, and he put on his sneakers. And the other guy said, "What do you think you're going to do by putting on your sneakers? You think you're going to run faster than the bear?" And the guy said, "No, I'm going to be running faster than you." So basically, this is what is going to happen. Thank you very much. We're done.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you to the panelists. Enjoy dinner.